happens for you. Good morning, everyone. How are you? It's good to see you. Will you stand? Let's worship together. I'm not gonna wait for the walls to fall, 'cause I know a name that can bring them down. I've got a praise waking within my soul. I'm not ashamed.
Go ahead and be seated. Great to see each and every one of you today. Aren't you glad that nothing can stand against our God? No matter what you are going through today, He reigns above it all. He is in control, and we have so much to be thankful for and to praise Him for today. Thank you for being here today. Welcome. It is so good to see each and every one of you. If you are visiting for the first time here at Coastal, welcome. We're so glad that you chose to worship with us today. And if you haven't had the chance yet to stop by our new here table, I want to challenge you after the service out in the courtyard to just stop by. We would love to get to meet you, have you fill out one of our Connect cards. Just a way for us to get to know you a little better. And if you have any questions about our church, we would love to have that conversation with you today. Thanks for being here. And if you call Coastal Life home, welcome back. It is so good to see each and every one of you. Thank you for your faithfulness. And, you know, I'm so grateful that we have a church that is concerned and excited. Every week I have people calling in and asking, you know, how can we get involved? And I'm just thankful that we have a church that wants to get involved, that is concerned about our community. And I'm so thankful that you give so that this church can continue to reach our community and reach this world for Christ. And as always, we have three ways that we can give here at Coastal. You can give on our website at coastallife.church. You can give in the offering box on your way out today. You can also get on the church app and you can give there as well. But thank you for your faithfulness and for your love and your heart for our community and this world. We've got a lot of things going on here this week. Lots of announcements. This coming Wednesday at 6 o'clock, our monthly night of prayer, I want to invite you to come out to that. There's just something special about gathering together corporately and lifting up our hearts in worship and taking our concerns and our cares to the Lord. And we want to invite you to come out 6 o'clock this Wednesday and join with us in prayer. Also, on February 11th, we've got child dedication here at the church. And if you are interested in dedicating your child or your children to the Lord during that service, you can go on our website, also on the church app, and you can register for that. And if you have any questions about child dedication, please stop and see Pastor Jeremy or Nadia. They would love to talk to you about that. Then on February 25th, our next baptism is scheduled, and I'm excited about that. People that have come to know the Lord as their Savior, ready to take that next step of obedience, the first step of obedience in following the Lord in baptism. And you can register for that on our website, also on the church app. And if you have any questions about baptism, please come and see me at the Next Steps table. And then tomorrow is the last early sign up for Upward, the spring season, just around the corner. And that is just an awesome outreach to our community, also for our kids here at the church. Flag football, cheer. If you'd like to register them for that, you can get on the website, church app. Any questions you may have about Upward, please see Pastor Jeremy. And I know he really needs volunteers still for Upward. And so if you'd like to volunteer in that ministry, please see Pastor Jeremy. Let's stand together and let's continue to worship our Lord and Savior today.
Out of the wilderness, into your deliverance, look where I'm standing now. These hands that my Savior rescued me. Hallelujah, I'm free.
Would you join me just in an attitude of prayer? Just close your eyes for a minute. That song that we just sang said, 1,000 hallelujahs. The word hallelujah is simply is another way to say praise. 1,000 praises we raise to you, Jesus. This morning, write to yourself, I want to ask you, in your mind, think of one reason and one way that you personally in your life could lift a praise to God. And just in an attitude of prayer and the quietness of your heart and your mind, I want you to pray that praise to God right now. Jesus, we praise your name. We praise you as our Savior, as the one who brought redemption into our life, who made salvation possible. We praise you for salvation. God, as our Father, I praise you for the beauty of your creation. God, I think of the incredible colors of the sky this morning when I woke up. Your creative creation. God, you are worthy of praise. You are worthy of hallelujahs. We give you honor. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. You may be seated today. Great to see you today. I'm so glad that you are here today. We're coming close to the end of this series that we've been in for several weeks now called Our Imperfect Family, where we're just looking at the fact, understanding this, that none of us have perfect families. There are things that we all have going on that sometimes we struggle with, that sometimes we got to give attention to, and as easy as it is to put a facade up and make it look like our family's absolutely perfect. The reality is we know that no family is perfect. I want to encourage you to be here next week. Next week, I'm going to wrap up this entire sermon series, and I'm going to be sharing some things with you that I just learned about 4 or 5 years ago in the life of our family that I promise you, no matter what stage of life you are in as a family, no matter what stage of life you're in as a family, no matter what role you play in your family, the thing that God taught me about 4 or 5 years ago is something that you need to hear. Because I believe we all need to understand this in the life of our family. So make sure you are here next week as I wrap up this sermon series on our imperfect family. Today, I want to talk to parents that are in the room with us. And I know we have all different kinds of parents in the room with us, all different kinds of people. We have some parents that are parents of little babies right now. Like you're trying to figure out this whole baby thing. There's some of you that are parents of young children. You kind of got that school age children. Some of you are parents of teenagers, and we are praying for you every single day of your life. And there's some of you that are parents of young adults, and you're trying to figure out now how do I parent a young adult and an adult now. Some of us are grandparents now. The greatest kind of parent that there is. I'm just saying. The greatest kind of parent. Some of you are foster parents. Some of you are single parents. Some of you are sitting in this room today, and you hope to one day be able to be a parent. I don't know where you may be, but I think we all have this. I mean, how many of you have parents? Because that's a trick question. You all have parents. Making sure you're awake there. You wouldn't be here if you didn't have a parent. We all have parents, and here's the reality. For those of us that are parents at any stage, parenting is not for the weak, is it? Would you agree with that if you're a parent? Parenting is not for the weak. Several years ago, a Christian author by the name of James Dobson, he speaks and writes a lot about family. He released a book with the title this, Parenting is Not for Cowards. The reality is, parenting is not for cowards. Parenting is one of, if not the toughest job that you can have. I mean, here's the thing. Being a parent is probably the toughest, if it's not the absolute toughest job that you could ever have. And here's the crazy part about it. You practice, you figure it out as you go. And then when you finally kind of figure out parenting and you finally kind of get decent at it, what happens? They're grown and they leave and you're out of that kind of job. You're like, wait a second, I just now figured this out. And now they're moving out. I remember when we very first became parents. We were young. We were like 23, 24 when Kaylee was born. And we were young parents. And I remember, and maybe you remember this time when you became a parent for the very first time. And you left the hospital to go home. For us, we were young. I said we were like 23, 24 years old. Kirsten and Kaylee had been in the hospital for almost 2 weeks due to some complications and stuff. But I remember that moment when we get home. You know this, you know, when they put your wife and she's holding the baby and they're wheeling her down to the car. They put them in the elevator, take them down. You pull the car up. Dad, you're the one carrying everything that everybody has brought, you know. You got balloons and stuffed animals and pillows and blankets. You're trying to carry everything down to the car. You get everything in the car, and then they help you, you know, the nurse, they help you put your baby so gently in that car seat. You buckle everything in, make sure you don't pinch anything. There will be a day that you pinch, just so you know. Very so gently, you're putting them in that car seat. You buckle them in, and you get in, and you get in, and you close the door, and then the nurse starts to wave by. And you're like, oh, wait, aren't you coming with us? I mean, I don't know how to do this by myself. I don't know what I'm doing. I was a kid, but doesn't mean I know how to raise a kid. And you start to figure out, like, I don't know what I'm doing here. I don't know how to do this. And then when your kid starts to grow a little bit and they start to get a little older, you just have this thought, I just hope I don't screw them up. Did anybody have that thought when you were a parent? Like, I just hope I don't screw this child, this human being up. You know, our job as parents, it's kind of like a potter who takes a lump of clay and molds it into something incredible, molds it into a cup or into a pot or something useful that has design and has purpose. And it's like a pot. That's kind of what parenting is like. I don't pretend to know a lot about pottery and molding and shaping things into a, if I were to make a cup, it would look like a kindergartner brought something home. That's what it would look like for me today. But I do know enough about pottering, some basics. Like the first thing that a potter does, they take this lump of clay and they begin to knead it. And they begin to knead it just means that they're pushing on it and they're folding it and they're pushing down on it and they're pulling it and they're stretching it. And what they're doing when they're kneading this lump of clay is they're softening it. And then after they make that lump of clay and they've kneaded, they've molded it, they've folded it, and they've pushed on it, and they've pulled it, and they've made it soft, then that potter will take, and they've literally called throwing, they throw this lump of clay on this pottery wheel, and it begins to spin, and this is called the throwing of the clay, and some of you know a lot more about this than I do, and all of a sudden, as that lump of clay begins to spin on that potter's wheel, that potter will take their hands, and they'll begin to push on it, and shape it, and mold it. Sometimes they'll take some tools, and they'll shave some things away while that lump of clay is spinning around, and they take it, and eventually after a good decent amount of time, and sometimes it's multiple processes of spinning that thing and molding it and shaping it and pulling it away and pushing in on it and using tools to shape it. Once they have finally got it into the shape that they want to be, they then take that lump of clay that's now turned into this cup or this pot, and they put it in the kiln. And the kiln heats it up and it hardens it and it kind of solidifies everything that was supposed to be. The reality is parenting is very much like that. You take this lump of clay called this child and you begin to knead it and you fold it and you push on it and you're pressing it and you're pulling it and you're softening the life of this child. And then there's a season of life that they're kind of on the potter's wheel and they're spinning around, and what you're doing is you're keeping your hands on them and you're molding it and you're shaping, and there's times that you have to take some tools and you have to shave some things away that don't need to be there, and you're pushing on it and it takes time, and you're going over and over and over again, and you're kind of just shaping it exactly the way it needs to be shaped. And then the reality is sometimes we have to let our kids go through some of the heat to solidify some things that we've tried to shape in their life. And as parents, that's one of the hardest things to do. It's to let our kids go through some of the tough times, to let our kids go through some of the hard times, to let our kids go through the heat and the fire of life, so these things that we've shaped in them are solidified in their life. But that is what our job is. That's what our role is as a parent. It's to shape our kids into who God would want them to be. As Christian parents, as Christian moms and dads, it should be our heart's desire, it should be the goal of us in our life to shape godly character in the life of our sons and our daughters. You see, you need to understand this. Character formation is much more important than behavior modification. So many times we as parents, we want our kids to act right, good, right? Like how many times have you as a parent said, we're getting ready to go out in public, you make sure you act right while we're out there, all right? You make sure you behave while we're out there. That's important. But the reality is sometimes we in our minds as parents, we get so focused on behavior modification that we forget that what is the root of that behavior is the character formation of our sons and our daughters. As Christian moms and dads, it should be our heart's desire to put our hands in the life of our children as we have this opportunity to shape them and mold them and do our part to help develop some godly character within them. Today, I want to give us three things that I think the Bible teaches us. Three practical things that I think the Bible teaches us about how we can help shape godly character into the life of our kids. First thing is this. Parents, you need to teach your kids to love God. Parents, this is the foundation of it all. Do you notice that I didn't say that here's the most important thing that you need to do as a parent? You need to teach your kid to be a good person. I didn't say you need to teach your kid and help your kid to be an honor roll student, or that you need to teach your kid and help your kid to be an all-star athlete, or teach your kid and help your kid to be the most successful business person that they can. Maybe you even have the family business that you're ready to hand off to them eventually one day. I didn't say that is all the most important thing. The most important thing that you can do as a mom and dad, the most important thing that we can do as parents is to teach our kids to love God. Do you understand this? The most important thing that we can do for our kids is to help them to find and follow Jesus. It's what we talk about all the time here is the mission of our church. The mission of our church is to help families find and follow Jesus. Do you realize the most important thing, the foundationally most important thing without any question, the most important thing that you can do as a mom and dad, as a Christian mom and dad, is to help your kids find and follow Jesus. What does it mean to find Jesus? It's the gift of salvation that we find in Jesus. And I'm telling you, it's not someone else's job to teach your children about the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not someone else's job to lead your child to the place of salvation. Moms and dads, it is our job to be the ones who are sitting and talking to our children through their different stages of life and laying a foundation for them to understand the reality of sin, for them to understand the reality of Jesus Christ, for them to come to understand in their minds about the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. This is the most important thing that we as mom and dads can do, is to teach them about what it means to find Jesus as their Savior. To follow Jesus. Parents, don't delegate your child's faith formation to somebody else. Well, isn't that the job of the church? Isn't that the job of the kids' ministry? Isn't that the job of the youth and the student ministry? Absolutely not. Do you know what the job of the children's ministry and the youth ministry at our church is? It is to support what is being taught in Christian families, and then to kids that come out of homes that are not led by Christian families, to help them find and follow Jesus. But for those of us that are in this church and we are Christian families at our home of who we are, it is the job of our youth ministry and our student ministry to simply support what you are doing at home. You see, parents, it is the most important thing we can do is to teach our kids what it means to find Jesus as their Savior and then what it means to follow Him in their daily life. To teach our kids what it means to love God. And like I said, don't delegate your child's faith formation to somebody else. This discipleship, helping someone understand their need for Jesus Christ all the way to their spiritual maturity. Discipleship starts at home with us, mom and dad. Look at this verse. I'm going to look at three different sections of scripture today. First one, in the Old Testament, the book of Deuteronomy. Grab a Bible really quickly, turn there. If you don't have one, you can see on the screen. But I always encourage you to have some kind of, electronically or printed, some kind of Bible with you. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Look with me in verse 4. Listen to what the scripture says. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You know this section of verses? It's actually called, in the Jewish tradition, it's called the Shema. The Shema is like the most important thing, the pivotal scripture that the Jewish people, the Jewish tradition is all based around. That the Lord our God is one. That we should love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, and with all of our might. And he said this, these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. Then look what the next verse says in verse 7. He's now speaking to parents. He says this, you shall teach them, well, what are we teaching them? That the Lord God is one, that he is real, that we should love God with all of our heart, soul, and mind. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. Here's the commands from God. He said this, understand that the reality of God, and then understand the how you should love God with the deep, with everything about you. You should love him with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. Your love for God should be deep and real and passionate and active. And then he says, teach that diligently to your children. Not just kind of, well, I hope they kind of pick this up. Every so often we'll talk about these things. If I remember, I'll do something to talk to them about God in some way. No, he says this, diligently teach these things to your children. And then look back at verse 7. He says, when you teach these things to your children, it should just be an active part of every day of your living. And he uses these three phrases. These three phrases, I want them to truly just be kind of like some very, very practical things. He said, first phrase, he said this, when you are sitting in your house, when you sit in your house, what's a practical way to think about that? Think about this. When you're sitting in your house, family dinners with spiritual conversations. I mean, I understand this, and I will not pretend when we had our kids at home, I will not pretend to tell you that every single night we sat around the dinner table together as a family. But I will tell you this, it was a high priority that we did it as often as possible. I think it is a dynamic that has left this generation of families for some reason. In our society, we've gotten so busy We work long hours. We come home just in time to put something in our mouth as we get in the car to go somewhere else, or we just don't want to do anything. Everybody just kind of goes on their own way, whatever it may be. It is a lost dynamic that I think is crucial in families, where families sit around at the dinner table. And guess what? You sit around the dinner table and you put your phones in the other room. You put your phones in the other room and you sit around a meal together and you have some intentional spiritual conversations with your kids. I'm not talking about preaching at your kids at the dinner table. I'm talking about asking them about things that are going on in their life. Asking them about what are things that they're learning about God, what are things that they're having in their devotions, and depending on their ages, you can ask them all different kinds of spiritual guided questions. You share things that are going on in your life spiritually. You share with them things that God is teaching and challenging you with. But you want to talk about practically what this means? Like, what does this look like in our society to diligently teach these things to your children? And you do it when you're sitting in your house? Well, start at the dinner table. Make it a priority and say, while we're here, we're going to talk about life. We're going to have fun. We're going to laugh. But then we're also going to have some intentional spiritual conversations while we're eating this chicken. He said this. How about when you walk by the way, that verse said? What could that look like in our life today when their society, what they remember, they walked wherever they went. They're in their day, wherever they were going, they would walk. Here's a very practical way of what this could look like in our family today. When we're walking our way, we're in our car and we're driving somewhere and we're driving our kids to school, or you're driving your kids to the activity. What if you simply said, you know what? In our car, we're just going to listen to Christian music. I'm not one of those guys that Christian music is the only kind of music I listen to. I am picky about what kind of music I listen to, but I'm not that kind of like, hey, you can't listen to anything other than Christian. Some of you that you may have that standard, your family, and that's awesome. That's great. But I will tell you this. When my kids were younger and our kids were in our car, 99% of the time we had Christian music playing. Why? Because I wanted my kids to hear lyrically the things of God, the truths of God, the praises of God, the worships of God. Man, you're driving your kids to school. You're driving them to that activity. You're just going to run errands and the kids are in your car with you. What if you simply said, you know what? If I'm going to diligently teach my kids to love God, when I'm walking on my way, when we're in the car, let's just have Christian music playing in our car. He said this, here's how you practically do this. You teach these things diligently to your children when you're sitting in your house, when you're walking by the way. Then he made these statements at the end. When you lie down and when you rise. You know what that can look like practically in your family life today? When you get up and when you get ready to go to bed, you pray with your kids and over your kids. One thing that we did in our family life, I'm not pretending that we had it all together. We messed up as parents all kinds of times. But one of the things that we did in our family life is we made sure that every single night we prayed with our kids before they went to bed. We would kneel down by their bed. We would sit on their bed, whatever it would be. As they got older, we would just, whatever the context of it looked like, we prayed with our kids every single night. We prayed with them and we prayed over them. When our kids were at the age that we were having to drive them to school, every single day that we were on our way to school before we got to that car line that we had to jump in and get through and get out and all that kind of stuff, before we got into there, you know what we did? We prayed with our kids and over our kids for their day that day. Every single day that we dropped them off to school. Why? Because we just understand this verse. To diligently teach our children to love God. If we're going to shape godly character in our kids, the first thing that we need to do is to teach our kids to have a love for God. The second thing is this: give them a model to follow. See, you may have grown up in a home that you didn't actually have a very good model to follow as a parent. Maybe you didn't have that mom or dad that were godly. Maybe you didn't even have a mom and dad actively involved in your life. But what we can do today As moms and dads, we can make sure that we give our kids a model to follow. Look at this verse in Proverbs. Proverbs, it's a collection of words of wisdom and things and wise sayings and wisdom from God. In Proverbs chapter 22, look at what verse 6 says here. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6, it says this, and it's a verse that maybe you've heard times before. Train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he is old, he will not depart from it. Train up a child in the way he should go. In other words, show them which way they should live out life, how they should go in life. Model for them how they should live their life as a godly person with godly character in their life. Give them a model to follow. Give them the direction. Model them for how they should go. Jesus Christ, he set an example for us when he lived his life on this earth. He set an example for us and says, live like I live. Now it's our job and our moms and dads in those roles to then model what Jesus modeled for us, to then model that to our children and let them learn from us what they need to learn. See, your greatest impact on your children is not going to be the lectures you give them. And I was really good at lecturing. Anybody, any other parents were really good at lecturing? Come on. Kids, any of you have parents who are really good at lecturing? Yeah, I was great at lecturing. But the reality is the greatest impact that we can have on our kids will not be the words that we speak to them, but the life you live in front of them. You want your kids to be kind? Then set an example and let them see you being kind. You want your kids to be generous? Then set an example of generosity in your life. You want your kids to serve other people? Then you need to serve other people. They will learn from you by what they see in you. It's no longer about that statement. I hate the statement. You know, do as I say, not as I do. It's a bunch of crock. Kids will learn what they see in you. There's a country song by a country artist named Rodney Atkins. It's the title of this song is called Watching You. And the lyrics of this song tell a story about him and his young child, like 4-year-old son, going out and doing stuff one day. And all of a sudden he hears his 4-year-old son use a 4-letter curse word. And he looks at him and is like, hey, where did you, in the lyrics of the song, where did you learn that? He goes, I've been watching you, Dad. Isn't that cool? They watch us. You want your kids to be kind? Be kind. You want your kids to serve? Then you serve. You want your kids to be generous? Then you be generous. You want your kids to be loving? Then you be loving. You want your kids to be humble? Then you be humble. When we're talking about giving them a model to follow, one thing our kids need to also see in us, they need to see how to make mistakes, own those mistakes, ask for forgiveness, and then make changes. For some reason, parents think, I'm never going to apologize to my children. I will tell you, several years ago in my life, God grabbed a hold of my heart in this way. One of the most powerful things I think I've ever done in my life is go to my young adult children and say, when you were a kid, you saw me lose my cool a lot. See, I have a problem with anger. Actually, I don't have a problem with anger. I can get angry really fast and really easily. I have a problem handling my anger. One of the most powerful things I ever did was to go to my wife and then go to my young adult children and say, I'm sorry for the things that you had to experience and the things that you had to see and how my anger affected you as you grew up. I own it. God has been dealing with me and God is now changing things in me with how I handle anger, but I owe you an apology. And I'm going to tell you, your children don't have to be young adults before they hear an apology from you. Your kids can be young and you can say, hey, you know what? Hey, I'm sorry. I reacted in this way and I shouldn't have reacted that way. I said this and I shouldn't have said that. I own it. I ask for your forgiveness. And then I'm going to take steps to make changes in that. Your kids need to see how you can make a mistake, because we all make mistakes. Your kids need to see how you can own, and you need to own your mistakes, how you need to ask for forgiveness, and then how to make changes as you move forward from that. Talking about giving them a model to follow, I know, listen, I know we have a lot of single parents in our church, and single parents, single moms, single dads, man, what you do is amazing. And I just want you to know that I would never pretend to understand. I've never had to do it. I would never pretend to understand what you have to carry as a single parent trying to be a godly parent to your children. Keep going. When you get tired, you get frustrated, lean into somebody who can encourage you. Lean into Jesus Christ and keep going. But let me talk to the married parents for just a second. When we talk about giving your kids a model to follow, show your kids a healthy marriage. I'm not talking about a perfect marriage. None of us have that. But show your kids a healthy marriage. If that means you go get counseling, then go get the counseling that your kids need. The greatest gift that you can give your children is a healthy, God-honoring marriage. And so if that means you need to go get counseling, go get the counseling you need. If that means that you need to go on that marriage retreat, then leave the kids at home and go on that marriage retreat. If it means that sometimes you need to leave your kids at home and mom and dad, you need to go on a weekend vacation by yourself to invest in your marriage, and your kids go like, hey, why don't we get to go on that trip? Well, actually, this is a gift for you, because the better that we are as husband and wife, the better we're going to be to parent to you. You need to tell them that. Give your kids a healthy marriage that they can see and learn from. Third thing that will help us to shape godly character in our kids is this: foster a love for the church in them. Foster a love for the church. Be committed as a family to being actively involved in your church. I mean, I know we all have extracurricular activities that we love. We had all kinds of extracurricular activities that we loved. There were things that we enjoyed doing as a family. There were things that our kids enjoyed doing, and we supported them fully in that. Enjoy all of your extracurricular things. Let your kids enjoy all the extracurricular things that they enjoy. But make faith and make God a priority in your family. In other words, the things of God should not come under all these extracurricular things that we do. Man, I grew up in a church. I grew up, my parents were Christians. I grew up in a time where, man, I was at church all the time. Man, some of you don't even know what this is. Some of you do. Man, on Sundays, we went to Sunday school. If you don't know what Sunday school is, it's like church before church. And so I'd go to Sunday school, and then I would go to church services. Then you'd go home in the afternoon, and you would get to play a little bit. But then guess what? You went back to church Sunday night for a whole totally different service. And then come Wednesday night, we'd go to church, we'd go to prayer meeting, we'd go to youth group, all those kind of things. Man, I grew up like we would have a revival week once a year. We'd have missions conference. Man, I was in church all the time. But here's the reality for me: it developed a habit, and it fostered in me a love for the church. This is about us creating a habit for our kids to understand the need and wanting to be connected to a Christian community of people. Like, we need to foster that. We need to foster that in our kids and show them that they need to be connected to Christian community. We need to foster a love for the church in our kids, where they not only see the need, but they actually crave it. They want to be connected. How many times do we see young adults go off to college, and your young adults start their adult life, and they start to fall away from being connected to the church? Man, it's one of the most heartbreaking things for a Christian parent. It's one of the toughest things. Like, now your kids are making their own choices. And I just want them to, I want them to see the need. And I don't want them to understand and want to have Christian community in their life. Look at this last verse I want to share with us. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 24, says this: "And let us consider how to stir up one another, how to encourage one another, how to bring each other to love and good works." Verse 25, "Not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." It says, don't be like some, he said this, who have gotten the habit of stopping to be connected to a Christian community, neglecting meeting together. Like for us as family, as parents, like we need to foster this love for the church where they begin to understand how important it is to be connected and actively involved in a Christian community of some kind. But a lot of times our choices and our decisions, our priorities, it says to our kids, hey, God is important. The reality is, I think God is important. You probably wouldn't be here this morning. But so many times, our choices around priorities as parents tell our kids that God is important, but not as important as, and you fill in the blank. Hey, God's important, but not as important as this. I mean, it's about us fostering a love for the church so our kids, especially when they get to that college age and that young adult age, and they start to, that they understand and they want to be connected to Christian community. I saw this quote this week. Here's what it says: "What one generation finds as optional, the next generation finds as unnecessary." When we as a generation of parents find church and connection into the church family as optional, the next generation of our kids very easily are going to find it as unnecessary. The greatest impact that you will make on this world may have nothing to do with what you do or what you accomplish, but the greatest impact that you make on this world may be who you raise and how you raise them. As parents, we have been given responsibility to raise and care for the children that God has blessed us with. We have the responsibility to help shape godly character in them. So teach your kids to love God. Give them a model to follow. Foster in them a love for the church. Let me finish this by saying this. Some of you may be here and you're like, well, man, my kids are already grown. I didn't necessarily do that well, or I did it well. But what do I do now? Man, empty nester, I want to encourage you with this. It's not too late to have some kind of impact on the character of even your grown kids. It's not too late to have some kind of impact on the character of even your grown kids. Share really quick four things for parents of grown kids. Four things that you need to grasp and you can understand. You still have the opportunity to have an impact on their character. Number one, pray for them. Pray for them on a daily basis, no matter where they're at, whether they are following after God or they have strayed away from following after God. Pray for them. Be a refuge for them, a safe place. Be a refuge for your young adult kids and your adult children. Be a refuge, be a safe place for them. Give them advice and counsel. Look at the rest of the statement, when asked. Sometimes that's tough, but they are adults now. When asked, give godly advice and godly counsel to them. And finally, this, embrace this stage. For those of us that are just kind of entering into the empty nest and having adult children, man, it's tough. It's a tough adjustment. But embrace this stage and connect in friendship with them. This is the time that now you get to be friends with your kids. You don't get to be friends with your kids when you're raising them. I'm sorry. But now you get to be friends with your kids. embrace that stage. We as parents have been charged by God to help shape godly character in the life of our children. No matter where you're at in the stage of parenting, brand new parent or a grandparent and anything in between, I want to pray for you today. I want to pray over you. So would you just close your eyes? God, today, I want to pray over moms and dads who are at the stages of raising and shaping young children. Would you give them courage when they need courage? Give them godly wisdom when they need that. Would you help them to teach their children to love God? Would you help them to be mindful of the model that they are giving their kids to follow? Would you help them to foster a love for the church in their kids? God, I want to pray for parents that have adult children and they're navigating, trying to figure out how to do this. God, I pray that you would give them wisdom. God, I pray for those parents today that have a prodigal son, a prodigal daughter. In the name of Jesus, I pray over those sons and those daughters who are prodigals that you would bring them back. I pray through the work of the Holy Spirit, you would do something in those kids' lives. Would you help those moms and dads of prodigals to continue to be faithful in prayer, to continue to be loving? God, I pray that you would bring prodigals back home. God, I pray for those that may be in our room today who are yet to have children but have a strong desire to be a mom and a dad. And I pray, God, that you would be with them in this season. Walk with them closely. And if one day you bless them with the children, help them to be the godly mom and the godly dad that you desire them to be. God, we thank you. You are faithful, God. Be faithful and help us to be the parents you want us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
I don't always understand.
is true. Amen. Amen. Hey, we love you guys so much. Have a great, great week. Stay dry this afternoon. We'll see you next Sunday.
Your plan falls apart, but you still choose to follow. If it doesn't make sense right now, it will when it's over. There will be joy in the morning. There will be joy. To your feelings, it's like drowning in the shallows. Oh, you gotta keep believing, even in the middle of the unknown. 'Cause grace will be there when you come to the end of your rope and you let go. It may feel like you're going down now, but the story isn't over. Joy.